Mr. Steve.
Good morning. So I'm going to use formal language. If you recognize the language that I use, then you'll be very interested in the announcement. If not, just take a deep breath. It'll be over soon. Ready? The Judicial Council of the United Methodist Church has come to a decision on the matter before it, and the decision is worth talking through the implications for ourselves as individuals and our church. So I'd like to start that conversation this coming Wednesday night at 5:30. We'll grab a plate of food, and then we'll go into the coffee shop and have dinner and discuss the decision and make sure everybody understands what has been decided, what hasn't been decided, and what happens next, and begin the process of talking about what our future might look like. So again, if you understood that announcement, great. If you didn't, don't worry about it. Yay! Cell phones off. Okay. Seems like it's been forever since I've stood in front to preach, but it's only been 2 weeks. I'll be preaching on a scripture from 1 Peter, the first chapter, verses 13 through 25. I know that it's hard sometimes to hear with depth the scripture as it's being read, so I'll set it for you a little bit. Peter is writing to a group of early Christians who find themselves living in what we would call in the midst of a pagan culture where other religions were the norm and being persecuted for that. And the persecution ranged from sometimes physical beatings and difficulties to more often being excluded from business and having other types of retribution going on because they wouldn't toe the line and kind of fall in line with the majority. So Peter is trying to encourage these little bands of Christians to stay together as a church and not to take the path of least resistance, which is give up their Christian faith and become like everybody else around them. So it's entitled Called to Be Holy. Therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, "You shall be holy, for I am holy." And if you call on him as Father who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of Jesus Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. He was foreknown before the foundation of the world, but was made manifest in the last times for the sake of you who through him are believers in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. Having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord remains forever, and this word is the good news that I preached to you. May the Lord add blessing to the reading of Scripture. So So Peter is toiling to convince folks who are in a hard situation and could alleviate the difficulty of that situation, not only alleviate it, but make themselves even more popular than they might have been before they became Christians. He is encouraging them to stay steadfast to the truth for a couple of pretty obvious reasons. The first is you wouldn't have become Christians if you hadn't been running away from something, right? Don't forget what it is that drove you to the faith in the first place, because if you give up the faith, you're right back to that desperate strait that made you want to give your life over to a higher power. And the second is, even if it works and your immediate circumstance is made slightly better by giving up and doing what society says is right, it only lasts for a very short time, and then you go to meet the one who is eternal, and he will not forget that you rejected him. So those two things are Peter's encouragement. In our lives, we live under the influence of many lies. Most of them seem innocuous enough and not dangerous at all, but they can be dangerous. Let me do a recitation of some of the lies that I have lived under, and I'm pretty sure you will have also, but you don't have to admit it today. You can just sit there and look like that poor man. I can't believe how befuddled he is. So when I was a small kid, 6, 7 years old, I was the youngest of seven, and the older ones already had cars and boyfriends and girlfriends and freedom. And at that time, the great lie in my life that I told myself every Friday and Saturday night was, if only I could go out with the big boys out on the town in Casper, Wyoming, then I would have everything in my life that I need. I felt great duress at being trapped at home and told, you're too little, too young to go. So the great truth in my life was, if I could only be old enough to have a driver's license, then the whole world would open up to me, right, and would reveal itself to be my sweet little oyster. To add to the pathos of that description, let me tell you that at 7 and 8 years old, I not only could not go out with the big boys, but my mother did not allow me to go downstairs and just be by myself. I got to watch Lawrence Welk with her week. Malcolm said, I watched it last night. Yes. Malcolm, in an odd twist of fate, that which I so despised as a child, I watch frequently now because of the nostalgia. But, right? When you're listening to somebody as cool as the Bee Gees during the week, and then they give you Lawrence Welk, that is no way to go. I can remember just absolutely believing, truly believing with all of my heart that was what was wrong with my life. I was stuck at home with Mom watching Lawrence Welk while the big boys went out and had a good time. Your laughter tells me that you too, right? There have been circumstances in your life where you leaned forward and thought, if I could only have this one thing, either a freedom or a new thing to do or this person or whatever it is, then I would be set and I'd have it. That lie plays out all of our lives. So in Wyoming, at 19 years old, you were of legal age. I don't know, what is it in California, like 42? Let me tell you, they got a lot more rules in California than they ever thought of in Wyoming. So at 19 in Wyoming, you could drink, you could drive, you could marry, you'd do any doggone thing you felt like doing. Woohoo! So I made it to 19, at which no more Lawrence Welk for me. And I found a pretty woman who wasn't paying attention and got her convinced to marry me. Which means my bucket list was pretty much fulfilled at 19, right? I was old enough to go out. I owned a car. I could do whatever I wanted to, and I had a pretty girl. So it was a pretty profound disappointment to discover that I had pegged my hopes onto things that did not turn out to be true. Turns out that, in truth, my life was a heck of a lot better stuck on the couch eating popcorn and watching Lawrence Welk. Because at 19, I was also paying bills, working full-time, trying to go to school and cobble together some kind of education, and discovering I didn't actually like my wife some days. All that freedom, all those dreams come true, no more happy. In fact, more frustrated. So I did what any intelligent, practicing Christian would do at that time in my life. I decided that the problem with my life wasn't that these things hadn't fulfilled me, it was that I hadn't had my ultimate fulfillment yet, and that would happen when I went to seminary, where we would sit and hold hands and pray and discern great truths, and then they would license me to go out and tell the world these things, and all would be wonderful and rosy and glowy. I don't know what your lies were, but I know you told them to yourself. And I know that when you achieved them, or when you found them, or you got them, for a moment you felt like you had it all. And then as the reality of the situation sank in, you realized, I hope, that you were wrong. But chances are you just reload, right? You just reload the false dream part of your mind. You say, by golly, that didn't turn out to do the trick. So what I need is, in my case, I went through a stage where I decided what I needed was to be more successful, whatever that might mean, than my brothers. I don't know if it worked or not, because I never made it. If we could be accepted by our peers, if we could be the boss at work, we'd run the place differently, because the boss never does stuff right. Have you noticed that? I don't know what's the matter with them, my own self. So if you're on staff and you're listening to this, right? Believe me, sometimes I sit in staff meeting and think the same thing as you do. Why is he being like that? If you could just marry the right person instead of the wrong person, or if you could just get away from the wrong person, far, far away from the wrong person, so they'd never, ever have anything to do with your life again. If you could get a dog or a cat, or a dog and a cat that like each other. If you could lose 20 pounds, if you could gain 10 pounds, if you could get rid of the pimples, if you could get something to grow your hair back. I'm probably revealing way too much about my inner life, huh? Anyway, none of these things have worked for me. Really, they haven't. And it becomes a mystery how it is that we can dupe along our whole life buying into the next new lie. The next new idea that if only I could have this, or at certain stage in life, again, if only I could jettison that and just be done with it and make it go away, then I would finally be happy. The lie is that the world has in it the power to bring to you what you most deeply want, which is fulfillment and joy and a peace and a contentment. And that lie is told continually, so that sometimes people very late in their life are in a nursing home believing honestly that if they lived in a different wing, that they would be happy. The last great lie. In AA and in other recovery groups, they say some things that are so harsh that it makes you blanch if you've never been. Really. Really hard to hear. I'm going to share with you what I think is the hardest saying to come out of the recovery groups. This is not something you're going to want to rush home and put on a t-shirt or use as a bumper sticker, because if you have any sense at all, it'll just skewer you. This should stab you right in the heart with the horror of the truth of it. What they say is, the truth is, wherever you go, there you are. And in context of addiction, what it means is you run as far as you want to. That's great. So everybody here was lousy, and that's why you gave into the addiction and became a drunk or whatever it is. So you're going to move down the road to a new place, and all the people there won't be the same kind of human beings. You're fooling yourself, right? The saying clearly explains, look, it doesn't matter where you go, because the addiction resides inside of you, and it's a spiritual problem. It's not some other kind of problem. And until you take care of you, it doesn't matter who you surround yourself with or what your address is. You cannot run so far that you get away from your own horrific thinking and lies. Everywhere you go, there you are. Let's change that to every dream you have, it's still you doing the dreaming. Everywhere you go, there you are. Bad news if you're in search of a place or a person or an object that lies outside of you that you believe will convey happiness. I'm here to tell you the best news ever, if you'll excuse the wording, sober up and come to understand, my God, everything I ever wanted is available to me every single day of my life. I do not have to wait ever again. because everywhere you go, there you are. So no matter what circumstance life puts you in, whether it's physical ill health, whether it is imprisonment in a job you can't stand or having to work with people that chafe you the wrong way or any number of circumstances, none of it has any power over you as long as you are empowered from the inside. That's what Peter was telling the people he wrote to. Look around and understand the thing that brought you peace has nothing to do with their acceptance of you. It has only to do with your own spiritual work and your chasing after what Christ gave you. Wherever you go, there you are. So, I have lots of privileges in ministry. The first one that springs to my mind for all these years is free meals. It's a great part of the gig. They don't tell you that in seminary, but it is. You get lots of free meals as a pastor. A lot of them are potlucks, but still. I'm running through the list now after free meals. I've known lots of bishops. Well, let's go on to a different subject. I also get to see people in periods of their life when this truth that we're talking about moves from the realm of an idea that we might entertain to the only truth that will save them. So I have been over a lifetime with people when they found out that it was stage 4 cancer. I have literally gone to the lawyer's office and sat with someone as they wept and signed the papers that said the marriage has died. I've seen people at the very crux of the worst thing that they could possibly imagine in their life happening. And the reason I say that's one of the benefits of being a clergy is because over the years, I have moved from telling them that I just wish it wasn't so and life is unfair and it's inside just thinking this really sucks to a different conversation. And here's the conversation that we begin to have. I will say to people, well, I don't know if it's going to be God's will to remove this thing from you or not. We'll pray for healing, but I don't know if he will or if he won't. God makes up his own mind. But what I can tell you is you are being given an opportunity that you would never have pursued, but you should take full advantage of. Because with your cancer, you have a family and a circle of friends who are watching you like a hawk, and you can show them the most important stuff in life. You can teach them that no physical disease is stronger than God. You can find peace, you can enjoy your life, and you can pursue this thing in such a way that you leave them a legacy that is grander than anyone could dream of. That is a legacy of how to be strong when you are in fact weak. If you draw on the faith that Christ gives to you, this thing can be the defining moment of your life, even though it's the worst time of your life. Do you hear what I'm saying? To have discovered that through my own journey and through watching other people's journey, it is mind-boggling to me. It's almost impossible to kind of to wrap it all up into an easy thought for a sermon, but it's true. When someone signs the divorce papers and it's all done and the whole thing came unraveled, the big dream, if I grow up and I get married and I have kids, it'll all be okay, and then it's not only over, but it promises to be a poison in their life for years to come. The exact same thing is true. If you can draw on your faith, if you can find Christ at the deepest part of your heart and soul, this thing is going to turn out to be, in truth, the fulcrum point of your life in which you discover how really powerful you are and how much Christ has empowered you regardless of the circumstance. There is nothing for a person of faith that crushes us and gets to be the final word. In all things, we can not only endure, but we can endure with grace and with peace, and we can strive forward even during the hardest times, praising God and practicing our faith through the disciplines of the faith. Does that make sense to you? It turns out, as Malcolm helped me remember, Lawrence Welk was not my problem. My mom was not my problem. My teachers were not my problem. Living in Casper had a little bit to do with it. The churches that I pastor, not my problem. Really, The horrible, wonderful truth of life is I am my own problem. And I think it might be true for you too. If you're thinking to yourself, well, how long do I have to wait before my life feels fulfilling, before I get all this stuff, before my dreams come true, you're dreaming the wrong stuff. Because today, here and now, as we sit in this place, from the Christian viewpoint, you've been given the most important, beautiful, and profound good that it's possible to conceive. Peter ends his scripture by reminding the people, look, it's like grass, right? We're like grass. We grow and we're beautiful and we're bountiful, but the sun withers us and we die. Don't cling to something that doesn't have about it a measure of eternity. Do you know what happens if in your family you are the one with the most success and the biggest house, the most cars, and the most vacations? When you die, people rejoice. I've been around a long time in ministry watching the private lives of people, and I'm here to tell you it's true. If you have that much stuff, when you die, people rejoice because they think they're going to get a bite of the pie now. That's a horrible truth. Can we tell them in church? It's not to say that having things is bad. It is to say that believing those things will grant you eternal happiness is dumb. They don't have that power. And the lie will get processed to the next generation and the next generation and the next generation. The wisest people that I've met in my lifetime when it comes to that kind of stuff are people who make plans to take what they have accumulated in pursuing their own passions and distribute them in different ways so that they leave the world a better place and they don't hamstring their children and grandchildren with a false hope that will really prove to be false. In church, we talk a serious kind of truth. We don't talk, at least in this church, about a God who is so small and so narrow in vision that all God wants is what you have dreamt up for yourself, because that God would be foolish and a liar. If you're praying for God to give you the things that you want because you think the things that you want are going to cure your life, you should stop that. I believe it insults God, and it's a fool's errand. You should be praying for God to teach you freedom regardless of the circumstances of your life. You should be praying to God to make you the person that He wants you to be with the other people in your life who exist right now, not with some new set of non-sinful people, because they don't exist. Peter says to a little group of Christians really in a storm, stay sober-minded. Pay attention. You have everything you need, no matter what they think of you, no matter what they do to you, no matter what happens. You have everything every day that you need provided to you by the Creator of the universe, and it's in an abundant supply if only you will cast off the darkness and the lie and live in the light and the truth. Jesus Christ died for you, not because He wanted you to have stuff or pursue low-minded dreams, but because in His eyes you are a part of His eternity, and He wants you to build a life internally that will lead to that eternal living. Now, there is gallows humors in the worst of circumstances. When they took Karen's lung out, her parents were coming from Detroit. And I'll be honest with you, we weren't exactly rolling in the aisles all joyful and smiley while that process went on. But we did giggle a little bit. She decided it would be funny if when her mom walked in to the hospital room, she went, Free side note, it was hilarious to us. Mom never really got over it. But the freedom in that horrific circumstance when her parents came to see what had happened to her physically, the freedom to joke and to laugh together and to have that kind of feeling, it came not because we were spectacular people, but because we had in our hearts a spectacular God. And we both knew during the whole fight, this thing might not end the way that we want it to end, right, in the short run. But it'll end the way we want it to in the long run. That's a significant power that you can have regardless of your income, regardless of your past, regardless of what other people say or think about you, regardless of anything. The coolest thing is, in America, right, we have our mindset around everybody and everything should be perfectly, wonderfully equal, which is impossible. But in the Christian faith, that equality is so radical that we can scarcely even think about it. What I'm talking about today, that which develops inside a heart that follows Jesus Christ for its joy and understands to define your life by his definition of you, that's available no matter who or where you are. No one can take it away from you. No circumstance can damage it. It makes us radically equal, regardless of the inequality of the world we live in. Christians talk about good news all the time. The good news, you're free from your sins, and that is tremendous news. But there is news beyond that. The good news is in being free from the punishment of your past sins, you are set free to live life so that regardless of the circumstance, you have at your core what all the rest of the world is still making up lies about. A sense of peace, a profound sense of belonging because you live in the world of the one who made you, and a hope for the future that no one can disappoint because he's promised us that eternity is open to us. When I read the words of Peter, I will tell you, it is really powerful for me, and it ministers to me, and it helps me break away modern lies that I tell myself. It helps to center me again and to remember, even just at my age, 54, I've lived long enough to know what Peter said, if anything, is an understatement. The power of Jesus Christ in your heart, if you discipline yourself and follow him and live to please him and the way he taught, that power is such that all the rest of the world, with all of its great power, just falls at his throne, unable to touch you or to move you or to change you. I would say to each one of you, if you find yourself right now clinging to a desperate lie, that either getting rid of something or someone or adding something or someone to your life is all you need and then you'll be finally happy, to realize you're practicing unhappiness and you're going to get really, really good at it because everything and everyone will disappoint you. Really. What you want to get good at is this, deciding, I am so blessed today to be alive. I am so blessed that the creator of the universe has a mind and a will that he specifically paid a huge price to set me free, and I'm going to enjoy that freedom in the circumstance that I have today. It is free. You are free today to look at your neighbor, to look at your family, to look at your circumstance, and give thanks to God for them as if they were more than you ever dreamed of. You really and truly are. Or you can chain yourself up and hobble down the road and see if Christians are lying. For my own self, the bet I'm making with my life, Christians are telling the absolute truth, and the world continues to be a liar. You choose this day whom you serve. Let's pray.